Ham Radio Now, episode 146. From the Dayton Hamvention, Flex introduces the 6300, their cheap little radio. Right, right, Cliff? Cheap little radio?
Cheap little radio, right.
Greg is going to be so happy.
Relatively cheap.
Yep. So after our epic conversation with the CQ episode 145, I guess we can keep this quick because we spent a good deal of it talking about Flex.
Yeah.
But they have a new radio coming out. We'll tell you what, let's go look at the conversation with Greg Jurrens and see what that's all about. And then we'll talk about it a little bit. So okay. Pretend you're looking at a monitor.
Who the heck are you?
I don't
know. Oh, you're Greg Jurrens, K5. I want to make everybody a four.
I was going to say, you made everybody a four.
So. I did do that for some. I should make them a nine. That's where I started.
Right. Okay, that works.
I heard a rumor that you have a new product here.
We do. We entered.
And you released the information first to Europe.
The fact of the matter is it got delivered to some folks in Europe a few hours before it hit the United States. Yes.
You can claim it's just a time zone difference.
It is a time zone difference. They're somewhat ahead of us. So it got informally announced on Wednesday night, and then Thursday night at midnight in the United States, we went live with the information on the 6300.
Yeah, and it is.
It's our new Flex 6300. It's the newest member of the Signature Series family. We decided we needed to have the great features of a direct sampling software-defined radio in a combination package that fits the value performance features, kind of a...
Yeah, blah, 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 marketing speak. How much does it cost?
$24.99.
Whoa.
There just isn't another radio anywhere in the market that fits like this. So, yeah, we did this specifically. We said we want the performance of direct sampling, and it's got to be in the price that everyone can afford. So that's... We did it, and it was fun. It was a great engineering challenge to get there.
So now all the folks that bought 6700s and 6500s are kicking themselves?
No, absolutely not. It's about features. And the 6700 with its twin digitizers and the ability to do things like optimal signal combining and the contest grade filters, VHF, that radio stands alone. The 6500 is really that contester grade radio, single digitizer, four receivers, four pan adapters. With the 6300, it's less pan adapter bandwidth, 7 meg versus 14 meg. It does two slices. There's less things inside. For instance, the contrast grade preselector filters aren't there. So we had to make some compromises. But for the everyday ham radio work, it's amazing. And so the basic receiver functionality is the same.
So this would be your step into high-performance digital operating at the casual level.
That's a great way to describe it. Yeah, actually, if you are, we joke about Joe Ham. If you are an everyday ham radio...
Did you see my interview with Joe Ham?
No, but I had Joe Ham in a picture last night at a banquet. So no, I'll have to catch Joe Ham picture.
Yeah, there's a real Joe Ham out there. He's got two M's in his name. But,
oh, that's cool.
He put in a contribution, and I talked to him on Skype, and we had a great talk. And many people said, best interview you ever did.
Great.
This is now the best interview I've ever done.
Of course, it's the best one today, that's for sure. Wait, it's the first one today.
Yep. So give me a quick nutshell of those compromises again. How much this radio doesn't do the other ones do?
Sure. As far as pan adapter bandwidth, you can zoom out all the way to 7 megahertz on this guy. And I'll just zoom this guy out to 7 megahertz so you can see everything from 10 to 17 megahertz.
Yeah, I'm not sure why I'm trying to ask you to lead with the bad news either. tell me what it does,
okay.
Too.
7 megahertz is huge compared to, say, our older series that would only go out to a couple hundred kilohertz. Its bigger brothers will go 14 megahertz. This one does two slices, so you can be on two different bands at the same time or have two slice receivers. Oh,
diddle the knobs. I'll shoot the screen.
Absolutely. Okay, so for instance, I'm here on 20 meters looking at PSK actually right here, and that's right there. And so I can zoom all from 7 megahertz, and what I'll do here is I'll zoom in here, and we'll just look a little bit. And that's what PSK looks like as I zoom in, and I zoom in. So there's a lot of good stuff to do there. Sorry, I'm not quite awake this morning, but there's PSK. Well, down here, I'm zoomed way in on 40 meters, and I'm tuning around, listening to people on 40 meters, and You can actually see their signals in our new waterfall. Version 1.2 of Smart SDR, by the way, has a very nice waterfall features. Really cool things like you can stop the waterfall and back it up in history to see where people were, things like that.
And can you listen to them or just see it?
Right now, just see it. And we'd love to be able to, you know, figure out how to make it to play back and stuff. There are some folks doing that. We think that's a very cool feature. So now the 6300 does have the transverter port, so you can do VHF. It does have two different antenna connections, one at a time, though. You know, it's kind of antenna A or antenna B. It's got outputs for amplifier. It's got ALC. So it's got all the I.O. you need. It's just in a simpler package. And once again, you know, it fits that price point that we think is awesome. And I guess we were right because we built a few months worth of product and sold out in a week.
Yeah, okay. So yeah. I'm seeing, you know, two bands.
Yes.
But you were saying just one antenna, one antenna is listening to these two bands?
Right, yeah, we're using one antenna. Now, when we first developed the 6000 series, we were worried about that. We really were concerned that a monoband or antenna wouldn't work well. What we've discovered is even very high performance monobanders, like say a stepper, works exceptionally well as a receive antenna out of band. So even on the 67 and 6500, where you may have four bands or even eight bands, you get good signal performance. It's not uncommon for me when I'm at home to be on a 20 meter beam while I'm just kind of lurking, watching for 6 meters to open up. And the antennas work exceptionally well for that because the receivers are so quiet. Now, once you know that 6 meters is open and you go there, then you're going to want to get on that right monobander or tune your antenna or whatever. But this particular radio, the 6300, is great for those guys that have tri-banders or a multi-band antenna and things like that. It's perfect for that as well. So don't get... We were worried, but now we're not worried at all about the fact that maybe your antenna is not resonant on a particular band.
Yeah, not so critical for receive.
Exactly.
Is it the same software as the other radios, or is it modified software?
No, it's absolutely the same. Now, Smart SDR is aware, and so, for instance, it will turn off features that it can't do inside this radio. So it does know the difference between a 6300, a 6500, and a 6700, but it is the same software.
Okay. I want to ask you a left field question.
Sure.
Somebody was commenting the other day, and this is just a one-off comment, so it's not like a cascade, mm-hmm. that contesters don't use Flex.
In the past, software-defined radio in general has been tough, and the problem was that it's not the performance of the receiver. There's always been an acknowledgement, oh, wow, these are the best receivers on the planet. The bad news is the workflow has been very challenging. And by that I mean it's clicky. You got to click here and go there. And I will tell you what we've done, and we openly acknowledge that. So when we introduced the Flex 6000 series and the performance of the receiver was so compelling, now we have teams of contester groups. I guess I should back up. We've opened up an applications programming interface called an API. And so anybody that wants to develop software for the Flex 6000 series, like a new interface, we have an iPad control app that one of the guys did, we have several other things like that. So anytime we do that, they are opening up. Well, what's happening now is the big contester groups have put together their programming teams and they're developing custom contester API interfaces for the 6000. And we're really excited. So that means everything from total buttons to absolutely no interface, and you drive it with your favorite logger software.
So that's coming, but it's not here yet.
You're right, but it's close. It's a lot. It's a lot closer than you think, and it was a lot closer than nothing happening last year. So we're very excited about it.
And once you get it done, it's going to be a while before people are going to be willing to commit to something like this. They may love the radios.
Yeah. Well, I will tell you that there are at least two major contester teams that have committed to fielding these radios. And like I said, they're dropping serious engineering resources to get them integrated into their multi-type stations.
So they put one in and see how it goes?
A lot of times that's what happens. Actually, in a couple of cases, I can tell you that they're putting several in and doing things like SO2R and those sort of things with the radios. So it's feeling very good. Now, people have been contesting with our Flex Series radios for lots of years, but it's a person here and a person there and a person there. So we see this as a really good shift in the acceptance by the contesting community.
you are probably not going to be the radio of choice for the de-expeditions to carry out to remote islands.
Well, you know, you say that. I understand with that. But if I told you that I could rack these things up and sit them in a place like in another tent, and you could operate with your laptop, and oh, by the way, every de-expedition, every person has a laptop with them because they're logging anyway. And since all of our radios are network connected, you could put all the radios in one side of the tent or the hut where all the heat and the amplifiers and all the wiring is, and you could sit in a relatively lap of luxury over in the other side of the tent with the mosquitoes and the poisonous crabs and everything else, and without having to be right next to the radio. So there's a lot of work going on right now to advance that. Now, there's still more work to be done. I don't want to make it sound like it's just, you know, easy, but we have really created the plug-and-play radio, and it's all about that workflow, and we're working through it now. We're excited.
And now you've got a radio I could afford.
Yeah, exactly. This is Gary's radio now, and it's interesting. I've had one of these at home for the last couple of months, and yes, I get to play with all the radio toys. But as far as just general purpose, chasing W100AW, working a few de-expeditions, waiting for 6-meter openings, this is an amazingly productive radio. And I've just, it's been overwhelming that the basic performance of the radio is just exceptional. Because once again, it's direct sampled, no mixers, no noise. The other day I was down hunting submarine transmitters at 30 kilohertz. These radios will do that.
Did you find one?
I think so. I think I found, I don't know, have any way to correlate it, but I believe I found one signal that looked like it had man-made signals on it. So,
okay, a question for Jeff. And this, I'm sure you deal with this fairly frequently. Somebody's got an impression. They formed an impression. That impression sticks with them long past when things have changed. Jeff's impression, my buddy Jeff, AC4ZO, says, Flex doesn't do that well on CW, especially the new 6700s when they first came out.
Interesting. Well, so Flex Radio has not had a stellar reputation for high-speed CW since the very beginning. And I'm an okay CW operator. I can contest at about 35. So, you know, I'm kind of in the middle of the pack. And I will tell you, 5 years ago, it was tough. It was because of this thick pipe deal where you've got the radio and then you've got all the PC doing the processing. Well, when we pull all the processing inside the radio, that really made that easier. Now we have full QSK on every radio from our 6300 to the 65 and 6700. Our key down to full power output is 8.2 milliseconds. It's real QSK, and as a matter of fact, if you're a barn burner and you run split antenna at 45 words per minute and up, you can run real QRQ with two antennas and basically copy in between dits and dahs up to 100 words per minute. It really does work well now. And we made architectural changes because of that exact issue.
Look right into this camera and talk to Jeff.
Jeff, it's awesome now. I'm telling you. Come play. We have a battle here in the booth. We've been doing this because people have this issue. And what's happened is it's been, we're having to overcome that history. 11 years of CW is okay. Well, this CW is awesome. It really is.
Okay, one last thing, a totally different direction.
Sure.
My buddy Bruce Perrins has been developing this free DV stuff and talking about putting it. He mentions Flex. He says he'd be the first one that would be able to handle something like that. That would be digital voice on the mode button rather than in through virtual wiring and stuff like that. We're getting punked behind you.
Yeah, no problem.
Have you been talking to him about that or one of your engineers?
Absolutely. Actually, Steve Hicks, N5AC, who's our VP of engineering, has been working with the digital voice crew, and they're working on concepts on how to integrate modem, or the codec, if you will, the coder decoders, inside the radio. And there's lots of horsepower in these radios, and this is a very awesome idea. Yes, now it already works. And you, by the way, the old virtual audio cable software that you had to install and things like that, that's all fully integrated in SmartSDR now. So it's very simple. It just shows up as a sound card. But we want to take that next step and go a little farther. So we are working with those people. There was a paper presented at DCC last year where we made some ideas and speculation. That's continuing now. And nothing quite ready to announce, but we are working with it. And yes, a lot of the digital voice folks are using our radios as we speak.
a niche audience at this point, but something maybe big in the future.
Yeah, but that's how things start, is a niche audience to begin with. So there's a lot of work going on, a lot of digital modes. The 6300, for instance, is ideal for the digital modes because without the mixers, without the noise, without the spurs, you can do all the decoding way below the noise floor that all the JT modes are looking for. So it really works well for that.
And mention the price of the 6300 one more time. It's $6,000 how much?
Yeah. Yes. Yes, I'm sorry. Here's the joke. We've broken the paradigm that says that Flex Radio's part numbers equal their cost. That's my favorite rumor. The 6300 is $24.99. There's an optional antenna tuner for $299. So it's right in that sweet spot. Our other radios, the Flex 6500, is currently $42.99. And our top-of-the-line Flex 6700 with the twin digitizers, it's kind of like stacking two 6500s together and then synchronizing the digitizers for doing things like that. And it's $74.99.
All right. Thank you very much, Greg.
Hey, Gary, thanks again. I always enjoy chatting with you guys. Appreciate it.
So, Tim.
Yes.
I forgot to ask Greg a question.
Okay.
That $2,500, that includes this big monitor, right?
I'm afraid not, but you can go get this at your local Best Buy for a very affordable price.
So what do you think? You going to buy one?
Eventually, yes. One of the Flexes. I don't know about the 60, yeah. The 63. I'd probably go for the 6700.
You want the big puppy.
I'm a contester. I want the big one.
Yeah. Did you think Greg was on track somewhere with his contest comments?
Yeah, I do. Up until recently, I wasn't aware that there were any issues.
Sit up. You've lost your headroom.
Okay. You going to cut that out and rewind?
No.
Oh, gee, thanks. See, this is what I get for not being the floor director. But to get back on track, there had been comments in the past about contesters not being thrilled about the radio on the transmit side. And I wasn't really aware of it until recently. But his comments about the workflow, getting contacts from the radio into logging programs and, just what you have to do when operating in a contest, it was rather enlightening, but it looks like they're on path to address a lot of it.
What are the deals with the transmit side? I've never heard anything commented.
Well,
about
we all know it's a great receiver. But if you're, in the past, everybody that's been running computer logging programs, they'll connect their computer to their radio with a cat cable or some other, external interface. Usually it used to be serial port, more and more now it's USB. With this radio, with the Flex, a lot of the radio work effort is in the computer. So how do you connect that? It has to be done through software. And from what I understand, there have the APIs, the application program interfaces, were missing until recently. They've been working on it. I'm not clear from his discussion exactly what has been done, but understanding that I'm a programmer, what he says is really high-level stuff to me. What I want to know is how deep do the APIs go into connecting with software? And I know I'm drilling way down here, but to boil it down, essentially the logging programs have to be able to talk to the radio software, and that means APIs. Now, they're working on APIs. As he said, the contesting teams are working on APIs as well.
As I understand it, anybody can.
Oh yeah.
Anybody who wants to.
Oh please.
Start programming into Flexes, you got at least some of the hooks.
Absolutely, and that's what I think is going on here. You got the hooks into the radio done by API done by Flex. The contesters are doing the hooks they want. And then the next step behind that is all the logging programs have to get their hooks into those APIs to complete the link from the logging software all the way into the Flex radio. Once that's accomplished, it's going to streamline the workflow very well. And then, that's one side of it. The other side of it is tuning around and actually using the radio in a contest. To be perfectly honest, I have not had my hands on a Flex Radio other than demos at the at these events. What I really want to do is get my hands on one. I've got a couple of friends that have offered. They've got a couple of them. I'm going
to
see that.
You want to tell Greg? Greg, send Cliff a radio.
Yeah, Greg, send me a radio. send it to me. The first place in class in several of the in North Carolina in several of the last major contests. So I do play with them.
Yeah. What class was that?
Single op, unassisted, low power. Which that's another question that came up.
Low power being 100 watts.
Yeah, 150. It varies from contest to contest. But another question that's come up lately is, where do these radios fall into the unassisted or single or single multi radio? Where are they going to be classified?
That doesn't seem all that difficult to me because the radio's got multiple receivers built in. And other radios have multiple receivers, or contesters will actually use multiple radios. And they know what class that puts them in.
Yeah, but if you're using multiple radios to receive, you're talking about essentially assisted or unassisted. I believe that's where that comes in. If you're multi-transmitter, it's puts you either into single SO2R or into outright multi, where you've got more than two radios. But the receiver side of it, with the two slices that you can see, or in the upper radios, the four slices or the eight slices, where's that going to drop you? Jury's still out.
I don't know.
That's a question that's going to be answered by the community and by the people that make the rules for the various contests.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't be a bit surprised to see some contests go in one direction and other contests go in another.
Well,
so the future will tell.
Yeah. So you were saying that you didn't think the transmit was all that good, and my mind went to what distortion?
No,
fidelity.
I'm not saying that there's a problem with the transmit. I'm saying that
you're saying the same thing Greg did, that it's too clicky.
Well, no, that was another topic altogether. That was to do with the CW. And remember,
No. He was talking about contesting.
He was talking about CW contesting.
He was talking about any kind of contesting. You had to push too many buttons to get the radio to do what you wanted it to do.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I was thinking clicky. I was thinking in terms of tone of the key clicking.
No. There's never been key clicks. In the CW discussion, that wasn't key clicks they were complaining about. It was just how rapidly you could send it. I guess it had a speed limit. You couldn't go any faster. It just wouldn't make the dits and dahs right.
Yeah, you...
Well, and you didn't get good QSK, is that it?
Simultaneous send and receive. Yeah.
QSB. No, that's...
Clearly, neither of us are CW operators.
But I do want to say, I passed my CW test at 13 words a minute in front of the FCC examiner in the F Federal Building in downtown Chicago in 1965. Okay, that's my...
I passed mine at 13 words a minute locally. And what's even
more
embarrassing?
In front of a VE.
Yeah, in front of a VE. And what's even worse, I used to give the CW test.
Yes, well, you don't even have to know CW to give a CW test.
Yeah, you're supposed to.
Okay.
But yes, I am a 13 word a minute extra and proud of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, the workflow, the clicking... has been a problem in the past. I don't know what the current situation is other than what we just saw on the tape, which is another reason I want to get my hands on a radio and spend some quality time with it.
Yeah.
Because, frankly, I'm thinking the 6700 is what I want. And being a systems programmer and a database expert and a ham radio operator, a little more than an appliance operator, I would hope. I think that's
a little
the one,
more.
I think that's the one that'll fit my bill.
Okay. Well, we'll see. And we'll see what the contesters think about it. I'm certainly no contester. Yeah. Although, as you know, in a contest, I perform very well. I just don't specialize in it.
Yeah, as long as we can keep you awake.
Go ahead and tell the story. Go ahead.
What was it, 2 years ago?
You're on camera, solo, sit up, tell the story.
2 years ago, field day, we're working the 80-meter phone station. I'm the band captain, and I'm logging for him, and we're tuning around. And he's tuning around, tuning. He locks in on a station, listens to it. I told him, we don't have it, go get him. So he calls them.
Yeah, Cliff is doing the logging for me.
I'm doing the logging. He calls them on the air. They answered, and nothing. Gary, go get him. Answer him. Gary! He's asleep.
I fell asleep.
He literally fell asleep in the middle of a contest.
Well, it was like 9 o'clock Sunday morning.
No, it was more like 6 o'clock. It was the middle of the night. It was still dark.
Okay, were we on 15?
No, we were on 40. Or okay. Excuse me, 80.
Okay, yeah.
And
would have expected the noise to keep me awake.
In fairness, it was the middle of the night. We were one of the few stations still cooking hot, trying to make points. And you literally fell asleep in the middle of the contact. Now, having said that, in all fairness, that same weekend, we were running together. That day, that morning on 15, we were running. We actually briefly hit a run rate of about 240 contacts an hour.
I can do that.
Yes, and together we make a really good team.
If you're the contester, how come I'm the guy that is always harping on you to not say things like, please copy?
Because clearly you haven't been listening to me make contacts in the last 3 years.
Oh, you've learned.
That is long gone.
You finally learned.
Yeah, my contacts are short and sweet unless I have to run them out because the other guy can't hear me.
Field day is not the big contest. It is the casual contest, and everybody comes out who's pretty casual about it, and they learn all their bad habits.
Yeah.
Which when they go to, if they go to do real contests, serious contests, they purge themselves of those bad habits, or they make no contacts. And the bad habits are all the extra words. Please copy. You are. We are. I am. He is.
Yeah.
You know, it's,
if you want to get real efficient, you got to clear all that out. Just say what's minimally needed. And at the W4DW operation in past years, we have usually come in first in class, but the operation becomes. It's both a high-end contest and a low-end contest and a social event all rolled into one.
Especially ours, because we'll have stations that are very casual and stations that are blood and guts in the same group.
Yeah, and the blood and guts, unless you're a proven, efficient contester, don't even bother walking in the screen tent. Yeah, but we make it a point to get other stations set up so that anyone can come in and operate. I'd like to see more CW stations running in our operation, but how do we divulge onto field day here?
These programs can go anyplace.
Yeah.
I know how we did it, though. I was complaining about your contesting verbiage.
You know, you open that can of worms.
And wondering how you could be the big contester when I had to teach you how. I had to teach you how. Not everything, just that one little very important aspect.
I love the way your memory works.
We'll talk about channelization later.
Yeah. Oh, you did get my email.
Yes. Yes, I did.
We'll talk about that later.
Yes. All right, so once again, that is it for another episode of Ham Radio Now in the can. That's all I've got edited at this moment, but I get these online. Ah, look who's here.
What's a Ham Radio Now without an appearance from the bear?
This is the mouse.
Oh, the mouse. Excuse me.
This is Maui Mouse, one of our blind tuxedo cats. I got a camera for you, a camera just for you, Mousy. Say hi to the audience. Mouse says, hey, put me on your shoulder and shut up.
Cat.
On the shoulder and shut up, daddy.
Yeah, we'll put that cat together with the dog we saw at Dayton. Remember the guy came walking in and had a dog sitting on his shoulders?
He did. I've got video of that. We'll play that in a future upcoming episode. So,
cool.
What I haven't done here so far, however, in this program or the last one, is point back. Where's the mouse? He's sitting in the back of the table. Is point back at Arvin. And Arvin is the guy who's responsible for paying all the bills, which we incurred reasonably at Dayton.
Yes, and as Gary says, I'm expensive to feed.
Not that bad. One night at Logan's, that, and then a couple nights at Steak and Shake. Oh, I love Steak and Shake. And then a couple of Subways. It wasn't too bad. So anyway, if you enjoy our programs, and as I'm beginning to realize, I've got no reason to expect you will, that people came up to us. He had not quite beat him off with a stick, but there were a lot of people that came by and came up and talk, and then a lot of drive-bys, just love your stuff.
Yeah.
You were, I believe, impressed.
I was surprised. I was surprised. I wasn't...
Not impressed, just surprised.
You know, it takes a lot to impress me.
Okay.
But it was nice to see all the people that came up and said hi. And I expected some. I didn't quite expect as much as you got, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
Even Jeff said, you know, without wearing his green shirt or his hat or anything, with nothing to identify him, people came up to him and said, hey, love your work. Yeah.
Yeah.
The only person that didn't get any attention is the poor guy behind the camera.
So, ladies and gentlemen, oops, there he is. That is Cliff. What we need now is a little more love for the Cliff.
Oh, boy. So, this is why I like to sit behind the camera and punch buttons.
It turns out you don't do too bad a job in front of the microphone either.
Oh, I knew that.
And he's humble about it. All right.
I just had to convince you, you know.
So, meanwhile, back with Arvin back there, HamRadioNow.tv if you enjoy the programs. And like I say, at this point, I can't see any reason why you would. Help us out. Stop by. It's easy to do.
And click the pig.
Yeah. So, say who you are now.
This is Cliff Broughton, W4FT.
Senior executive producer of Ham Radio Now.
And chief cook and bottle washer.
Yep. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, the host of the program. And button pusher. Normally, you're the button. If we are here together, normally you're down here pushing the buttons. But
yeah,
the studio is set up for single operator mode. What would that be? S-O, single operator one studio? S-O-1-S?
Oh, you're stretching it too
single
far.
Single operator, three camera, two mic.
See, here's the thing. When he's got to do this, talk on the air, figure out what he's going to say to the camera, and push the buttons, he gets tongue-tied.
Never.
Always.
I thought I did as you'll see. Well, you saw it in the two programs we've got up so far. The Flex one you just watched and the CQ one if you watched that. I'm standing there with the camera and now I'm talking, I'm waving the microphone back and forth, which as you'll see in a couple of the upcoming programs, I get out of sync on the microphone. I'm talking and I'm holding it out in front of me and then never mind.
Use the microphone.
So the little point of view cam turns out effective, I think.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
At the very least, it helps fill in the audio.
Well, yeah, a little bit. You didn't hear very much point of view cam audio, but you will hear it occasionally.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Hey, so thanks, Cliff. There's an old rule. Stuff happens.
Yeah. We've identified ourselves. This program should have ended a long time ago. And now the great big thing floats in and goes, bong. Oh, we never said over and out.
Over.
And out. Bong.